recombinant, we need to go back to our surgical district. We don't want to have any pain. At the same time, we want to have complete range of motion, whether it is flexion, extension, radial and ulnar deviation, and the rotations. So all those movements, if you want to have, we want to reduce the chances of arthritis later on. So I think ORAIF is the answer, and that's what Arindam has told us. Any questions?
I think myself, Dr. Neeraj Jain, I've got two questions. One to you, sir. That in older patient and a bit old fracture, which we see quite common, say about 3 week old, and you can say it is collapsing and dorsal displacement in older age group, till how late time you still try for the close reduction?
2 weeks.
Yeah.
2 weeks.
So you get the successful.
When I say if the patient is not on plaster, I will put another plaster. While that, I will do a, you know, try a reduction. Whatever reduction I get, I, you know.
I'm talking initial 2 week old fracture, you reduce it. And one question for about plating, about volar and dorsal plating, there are a lot of plating. So which plating is, you see, literature says it's better, dorsal or volar plating?
Volar plating is really a mainstream plating. Dorsal should be done very rarely. So it should be mainly volar plating. And that's where most of the unstable fractures are. So it's volar plating is really the mainstream operation.
Because the dorsal side is the tension side. And
As I said, it's not something to be done regularly. It's something which you might have to do once in a while, just to know the... So because for the sake of completion of the topic.
Any indication for the dorsal plating, a specific indication for the dorsal plating? We all know the volar plating, but about the dorsal plating, is there any specific indication we should go for the dorsal plating?
See, if there is a very large dorsal fragment, which you are, you know, if you can fix it sometimes with a volar plate, that's okay, but you might find it difficult to fix it. And if you feel that you will not be able to reduce the instability, then you might have to put a dorsal plate. But as I said, it's not a common thing, which even surgeons who are doing a large number of cases, they only do maybe one or two a year. It's not very common.
Actually, you have to decide beforehand.
Yeah.
So if you want to go to volar or dorsal plating, but once you did the volar plating and unable to fix the dorsal fragment, then
if you have a doubt, then do a CT scan. Do a CT scan, see a fragment, and if you feel that you will not be able to fix that.
No, I'm talking paraplegic. Paraplegic, you did the volar plating and you found that you are not satisfied with the dorsal fragment. Then how you will going to proceed for to fix that particular dorsal fragment, which is not properly fixed with the volar plating?
I mean, it is possible to do it both sides, but it's not desirable because it obviously will cause soft tissue swelling and it can cause problems with the vascularity. But so if you are very unsatisfied, you can add a low profile plate.
Actually, with the advent of three column concept and the variable angle plate, if you see, almost all the fracture can be fixed by the volar plating with the locking plates which are available, whether you talk about the extra-articular or juxta-articular plate. There are only few indications where you will require the dorsal plating. One is if you have a displaced fragment which is dorsomedial, which cannot be fixed by the volar side, that is one. And that really you can make out while doing a CT. There is a specific dorsal medial fragment which is displaced, which is sometimes difficult to fix it by the volar side, then you can have a dorsal plate, separate plate, low profile, which is available, you can really put, there won't be an issue. But now with the advent of variable angle plate, I see that almost it is not required to go for a dorsal plating, because with variable angle, you can fix with the same plate the stellate process, and the very dorsomedial fragment can also be fixed by that variable angle plate. So really, if you're working and going through the normal plate, the normal 3.5 dorsal plate, yes, there could be indication where you have a small chip which is displaced dorsomedially. There you might require a small low profile plate. You cannot really fix it with the usual large plate, dual plating, no. There you will have a soft tissue swelling problem. There you will have a soft tissue healing problem. But with low profile plate, you can do both dorsal and volar. But if you're going for a variable angle where cost is an issue, then perhaps it is not required to really go for a dorsal plating.
Sir, I can add this thing to these options are good, but here is a very good option is that we can supplement our hybrid with the external fixation. With the vertebral plate. There is a hybrid type of fixation is mentioned.
Also, but the variable angle also gives you 20 degrees either way. So you get 40 degrees of play with the variable angle.
But the availability is the issue.
You can combine. You can do
cost. You can not availability is the cost which is an issue.
Any more questions?
If there are no questions, I would ask our panelist one last question. Considering that you are young, dynamic orthopedic surgeons, and you have one, a stable fracture of a dominant hand and a non-dominant hand, or unstable fracture with a complex kind C3 fracture of the right hand, left hand, dominant, non-dominant, what would be a mode of treatment that you would ask the surgeon to treat you with? Dr. Sunny.
What is the age of
yourself, you have a fracture. One is one stable, other is unstable. Complex so fracture of a dominant and a non-dominant.
Bilateral so fracture.
Beg your pardon? Bilateral. Not bilateral.
If I get a bilateral fracture, I must be blind. Only blind people fall on two hands.
Either right or left. Yeah. If it is right hand, if your treatment differs or left differs.
I am around 70s now. So 70 plus. So I think say my bones are quite strong.
Very good.
I will, you know, probably end up by my colleague to operate on me. Operate. On the right hand, probably left hand plaster.
Yeah. For the stable fracture. For the unstable fracture.
For unstable fracture.
Okay.
Stable fracture, I will put a,
cast both. But would you like to reduce it?
Yes, if there is a displacement, gross displacement.
And would you take an X-ray post-op?
Of course, I will ask them to. Because
thank you.
Even
thank
a very old person, only I said they don't take X-ray.
Yeah, okay. Dr. Anurag?
Probably for both unstable fractures in a patient of 70 years.
Yourself.
I myself.
Yeah.
If I'm quite young, half the age of sir, not half exactly, 40. So for myself, for unstable fracture, I will ask that one side you operate, that's the right side, and one side you do a plaster because you really need a daily working for that. For unstable fracture, both side I would prefer to go for an operation. But the most difficult situation is to whom should I ask to operate? That would be the most difficult situation for me.
Okay. And of course, Arindra.
Well, unstable fractures, I think regardless of whether they are dominant or not dominant, they have to be fixed. And stable fracture, again, I think regardless if it is doable with a cast, it's quite acceptable to have a cast and proceed, because unnecessarily operating, there's no point. Because one thing is there, that if you can treat a patient conservatively, in the long run, of course, the results in the are good if it is amenable to conservative treatment. So the indications have to be there that it is doable with conservative. But if it's not doable, proceed for operation.
Yeah, thank you very much. Just to give an information that in last almost 20 years, we have treated 32 surgeons and orthopedic surgeons, and they preferred to have their hand when they had complex fractures to be treated as with external fixators. That's what we have done. So when it comes to our own, when the surgeon comes, I think his treatment probably protocol changes. Anyway, we had a wonderful session today, and I would like Dr. Anurag to sum it up.
Thank you very much for this lively session, and it was such a useful topic to have gone through. Thanks everybody for kind listening.
A little bit earlier now because of the progression to adult scoliosis and because patients live so long. So there's no definitive classification, and what I was trying to do was to amalgamate the classifications for you so that very simply you could put what is a complex problem into an easy solution for you, and to try to determine the cranial, which is much, much easier, and the caudal levels of fixation for adolescent idiopathic scoliosis. In addition, you want to be able to determine which curves are structural and therefore which ones need to be fused. And I felt that actually looking at them, neither classification by themselves, but the Lenki classification and the Suk classification put together, gives you an armamentarium for you to tackle any curve. So if you wanted to try the Lenki classification, first off, you need to do your AP and lateral whole spine erect x-rays. You're defining the curves in terms of proximal thoracic, main thoracic, and lumbar curves. You're having a look to see, in fact, whether the patient is very kyphotic in the upper thoracic spine, because we know that sagittal problems are the biggest cause of failure, particularly in the adult population. But of course, proximal junctional kyphosis problems are a huge part of the pediatric deformity as well. We look at the structural curves and decide which ones we want to actually fix. But more importantly, we look at the major curves so that we can actually direct our correction techniques. And then we get a really complex classification, which I'm going to show you at the end. Hopefully you can just completely ignore, because this classification is fantastic and Larry Lenki is a very, very learned man. But in fact, when you look at this, what you're doing is you're classifying every single curve into one of six curves. In addition to that, you're deciding which ones are structural based on main thoracic curves and also lumbar curves. And when you bend out these curves, if they're greater than 25 degrees, it's a structural curve, needs to be fixed. But in addition, if actually there's a large kyphosis in the upper thoracic spine, you need to include it. If you're going to do a selective thoracic fusion and you're deciding to do that, and at the thoracolumbar junction you have a big kyphosis greater than 20 degrees, then you actually have to fix that thoracolumbar junction as well. So there's some good, nice defining rules that Lenki gave us. He showed us which curves we had to fix, but he didn't give us the levels that we had to fix to and from. So just as an example of that, this is a Lenki 1A curve, but it tells you nothing about this curve. So you still have to decide, despite actually classifying this curve, what levels you're going to fix. And his nomenclature and his classification doesn't give you that. It's a Lenki 1B. Again, fantastic for classification so that you and I can talk over the telephone and we know exactly what we're talking about, but no good in deciding fusion levels. You can look at a Lenki 2A. Doesn't really describe the curve really at all. It's quite a big curve in a patient. The A modifier tells me actually that the central line up from the sacrum is actually going right through and bisecting the apex of the lumbar curve, but actually really tells me nothing about the complexity of the main thoracic curve or the stiffness of that main thoracic curve. Again, with a Lenki 3C, we're getting towards double major curve with a flexible top-end proximal thoracic curve. Once again, it tells me nothing about that. When we describe it over the telephone to each other, we can have an idea what it looks like, but we really still have nothing in our armamentarium to be able to decide which levels we're going to fix. So that's what everybody really wants, isn't it? Because Lenki's classification is a research tool. It's very good at defining what the structural curves are. It's very good at actually defining what does a curve in general look like and classifying it so that you and I, if we do research, we're talking about the same types of curves. But it doesn't help you in the operating theater to decide what you're going to do for these patients, and that's really what you need. We can read books, but we need to actually adapt that and make it practical for ourselves. So then you need to look at the Suk classification, which again doesn't address everything that Lenki does in terms of structural curves, but is much, much better at actually looking at what levels one should fix. And actually his structural curves are based on four types. But in the main, you're looking at thoracic curves, whether they be single or double thoracic curves. That's the first two. And then actually you've got a double major curve, so of course there's a lumbar entity to that. And then you've got lumbar or thoracolumbar curves. So essentially, despite the fact that he's got four curves, in fact he's got two thoracics, and then he's got two that go into the lumbar spine. Either they're just a lumbar curve, or they have a lumbar curve as well as the thoracic curve. And then he has modifiers. He has an A and B modifier. So if we look at the subclassification, it actually seems like it's a little bit complex. I've taken bits out of the subclassification even for you, because his is a little bit more complex than even this. But actually, as a working tool, and this is what I'm going to take you through, is that for a thoracic curve, whether it be a single or a double thoracic curve, it doesn't actually matter. What you need to do is fix to the neutral vertebra or the neutral vertebra minus one. So that's pretty simple. So scoliosis made simple. Because all you've got to be able to do is determine what is the neutral vertebra. And the difference between A and B as a modifier is that if the end vertebra is the same as the neutral vertebra, i.e. zero, or the end vertebra plus one is equal to the neutral vertebra, then you fix to the neutral vertebra. If the end vertebra is three away from the neutral vertebra, then you fix to the neutral vertebra minus one. Make sense? So just determine the neutral vertebra. Decide how far that is away from the end vertebra, and on the basis of that, decide how close to the neutral vertebra you actually fix, either to it or neutral vertebra minus one. If it's a lumbar curve down here, and I'm going to repeat this with some x-rays, if it's a lumbar curve down here, we need to see, in fact, on our supine bending views, when we take the lumbar spine across the midline with a bending view, does the L3 vertebra cross the midline? If it does cross the midline, and on the opposite bending view, the actual rotation of the pedicles is less than or equal to a grade 2, then in fact you can fix the patient to L3. If it doesn't cross the midline and the rotation is greater than grade 2, you're fixed to L4. So the Suk classification is incredibly simple for fusion levels at this distal end. You're either fixing to the neutral vertebra or the neutral vertebra minus 1 if it's a thoracic curve, or you're doing a selective thoracic fusion despite the fact that there's a compensatory lumbar curve, or you're fixing to L3 or L4. In the main, we say in the UK, and particularly in our institution, we 35% of all the complex deformity in our institution never stop at L2. L2 is usually wrong. There's the odd indication where you can stop at L2, but it's usually wrong. So if we look at the things that you need for the Suk classification, you just need to know where your end vertebra is, and that's quite simple. It's the most deviated vertebra body. If you look at the neutral vertebra, it's the pedicles that are actually looking at you the most. And then if you look at the stable vertebra, it's the one that's bisected. It's the most cranially positioned vertebra that's bisected below the main thoracic curve or the main lumbar curve. So if we look at thoracic curves, first of all, because I wanted to show you some images to see how simple it was and to see what happens when it goes wrong. So initially, now we're just going to deal with thoracic curves. There's no significant lumbar curve, or we've decided not to fix the lumbar curve because we think it's compensatory. So we know what our rules are. We basically need to look all the time to see how close the end vertebra is to the neutral vertebra. So if we look at a single thoracic curve, we're looking at type A and type B. And here's the difference between the type A and the type B. And this will determine whether you fix to neutral vertebra or neutral vertebra minus one. So over here, you've got the end vertebra and the neutral vertebra, and they are one apart. Over here, you've got the end vertebra and the neutral vertebra, which are three apart. If it's one apart or they are the same, you fuse the neutral vertebra. If they're three apart, you fuse the neutral vertebra minus one. And it's an oversimplification of what Suk said, but that's essentially what it is in real terms. So if we take you through a few cases. So we determine what the end vertebra is, the distal end. We determine what the neutral vertebra is. We decide we're going to fix to the neutral vertebra because actually the end vertebra approximates the neutral vertebra. It's only one away. And if you fix like that, you get a very, very nice balance of your thoracic fixation. Again, here's a selective thoracic fusion. We've determined that this is actually a relatively flexible lumbar curve. I'm not showing you the bending views. This is just purely for classification terms. The end vertebra is still one way from the neutral vertebra. So you stop at the neutral vertebra, and I assure you say that that is actually in balance. If, however, you take a patient who the end vertebra is close to the neutral vertebra, but actually you decide not to stop at the neutral vertebra, but you stop at the end vertebra instead, which is what a lot of people do with anterior scoliosis surgery, you can see that the patient's been left imbalanced and will need revision surgery. So go to the neutral vertebra if the end vertebra is the same as the neutral vertebra, or they're one apart. If they're three apart, you have to go to the neutral vertebra minus one. If you look at a type B then, and this is where the end vertebra is further away from the neutral vertebra, so they're three away here. If we actually fix to neutral vertebra minus one, we get a very, very balanced curve. So we fix to L2, and in this case, L2 is correct, but it's unusual. If we look at when we get it wrong, we look at the end vertebra here. Sorry. Yeah, look at when we get it wrong, we look at the end vertebra here. It's three away from the neutral vertebra. We decide we should be actually fixing this to L2. We don't fix it to L2, we fix it to L1. We leave the patient with quite a significant truncal shift. And this gets worse. You look at it initially, 1 month post-op, it looks okay. You look at it a year post-op, it looks worse. And believe me, when you look at it 3 years post-op, you wish you'd picked a different level, because they all actually start to decompensate. And the problem is that a lot of these classifications have been written in America, where actually the pediatric orthopedic surgeons look after the patients. They think everybody who gets to 18 is fine, and then they just give them over to the adult deformity surgeons, and they have a major problem with these cases. And oftentimes you have to do either osteotomies in these patients or actually fix them down to 5. If we then come to the lumbar curves, so we've made our decision already on the thoracic curves up here. Now we come to the lumbar curves and we look at the A and the B modifiers here. So all we're really doing is deciding whether we fix to L3 or L4 based on whether in fact the curvature will come across the midline, past the central vertical sacral line, and actually whether the rotation of the pedicles is not too great. So just take you through a few cases. Double major curve type A. So type A means that actually when the curve comes across, it passes the midline. The rotation, you can't see it here, but I can tell you it's less than grade 2. Actually, in fixing that patient, we can fix that patient to L3, and it's safe. Here's a type B, when actually the, and very, very importantly, that you draw this line across the top part of the sacrum, because the patient often bends on the table. So it doesn't actually cross the midline. What we've got is the rotation is too great. We have to go to L4. The lumbar curves, this is just the linky type 5 curve, so there's no real thoracic curve. Again, the same rules apply. If it crosses the midline and the rotation is not very good, not very much, then actually you can just fix to L3. If, however, the lumbar curves, then there's actually an inability of L3 to get across the midline and the rotation is not that great, or so the rotation is too much, then actually what we have to do is we have to fix them to L4, and often with these patients we have to create more lordosis at the bottom end so we don't give them a sagittal imbalance. So the linky curve is very good for telling you what is a structural curve and therefore what needs to be fixed, but it's no good for telling you the fusion levels. I would, however, stick to the linky classification for nomenclature so you can do some research and also to know which curves you should fix. But I think I'd go to the Suk classification for knowing whether the actual what the distal level of fixation is. In addition to that, in the last slide, is that actually at the proximal level is very, very simple. If you've got a significant upper thoracic kyphosis, you have to go to T2. If the concave side is low, and that's in the shoulder, then you go to T4, so you push it up with your correction. If the curve is if the shoulders are level, then you go to T3. And if the concave side is high, then go to T2. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, Dr. Sonmalai. Now, I think that's a question and answer session will be the last. So may I call the second speaker, Dr. Prasad. He is consultant in Sandpower, UK. He is very...
This one? Yeah, this, sir.
Yeah. He is very humble and to come to the India and just have attend the conferences. Thank you, sir. Welcome.
Good afternoon, gentlemen, and thank you for staying back. And thanks to Professor Ramesh for obliging to be our chairman. This is rapid post-operative rehabilitation, but in spine, I like to insist that rehabilitation is required even in non-operative treatment. We know most of the spine, I know there are many general surgeons or orthopedic surgeons here. Our conversion rate is less than 1 in 10. So a lot of patients we treat without operation, so rehabilitation is very important even in non-operative management. Just a brief thing about me. I qualified from St. John's in Bangalore, then I did my master's in PGI, then went to UK. Now I'm working a consultant for a few years now. And whenever I do anything, I question myself, are we doing the right thing? How do we improve it? And also, is it evidence-based? And anything I was taught or I had to do, I compare with the basic sciences. Does it explain to us? This is how I improve my practice. Now, with regards to the rehab, when does it begin? So anybody can say that, because it's short time, but it can be interactive. My talk is short. When does the rehab begin? Think. It's not just before the surgery. You go on. Okay, that's what we thought, actually. In my books, rehabilitation begins with the first contact with the patient. Particularly, remember, in spine, these people have gone from person to person and they've been having a lot of pain, their body muscles are weaker, and they're depressed, and the pain perception is beyond the supratentorial area. It's not only in the back, it's a lot of psychosomatic and problems. So that it starts when we meet the patient first. That's where the rehabilitation begins. And how and who to involve in that. The most important thing I said is when it comes to the spine problems, not only the patients, even our colleague surgeons, it runs chills down the spine. They think spine is something very serious, dangerous. And the patient thinks, can they do anything? Can they walk? Can they sit? So it's very important for us to explain and inject that confidence liberally into patients. If they understand and they know what we are hoping to do and what we are achieving, we get the complaints and they will do better. And on surgery, I seldom use drains and catheters. Nowadays, we do mostly minimal invasive microsurgery, endoscopic. We don't really need them. But if we have to use all the time, like classical way, then that delays discharge and movement. And one of the most important things in my practice is multidisciplinary team is not just doctors, physios, occupational therapists. It is the patient. We always forget patient has a major role in the treatment of problem. We are not treating a problem, we are treating a patient. And patient should understand that 70% of actually work comes from him. We only do 25 to 30% fixing, operating, explaining, physiotherapists guide them, but it's the patient with his family support who actually does all the recovery process and get back to functional life. So we need to explain that to change his mindset and they should become part of the team. And where and how we do it. And it doesn't have to be classical physiotherapy department. The best way of rehabilitation is getting them to do their routine activities and engulf those, what we want them to do, put them into their routine activities. That's how they will do it more often. Like instead of walking on a treadmill, for example, you can just ask them to walk in the garden, walk on a seashore if there's a nice place, things like that. For cycling, use a cycle. Once they're out of anesthetic and they're safe, we all know early mobilization is minimizes all the complications. Make rehab a part of the daily activities. This is how we get their cooperation and compliance. One of the main things that stops that early rehabilitation is pain. Pain, it's a great perception. Everybody actually thinks pain is a protective mechanism. Doctor, if I do anything, am I going to make it worse? So that's how we have to explain to them. In a sense, it's true. Pain is telling you not to do too much, but you have to expect some pain after surgery, everything. So we have to just encourage them. It's not going to stop or spoil my surgery or ruin the surgery. You have to get going. Second thing is, during surgery, soft tissue handling, it helps a lot to decrease the pain, soft tissue damage. And I use local infiltration liberally so that they can start moving quite quickly. Instead of using patient control anesthesia, morphines, these local infiltration, keeping the patient awake and alert, rehabilitation begins much quickly. In general, on day one, same day as a post-op, ask them to do self-help, get up, go to the toilet under the supervision, start routine jobs, things like that. And I say avoid bending and work lifting things only as a guidance, but it's not a dictum. And they always ask for driving. In this country, it's different, but in UK, people have to be independent. Otherwise, they can't even get the bread and milk from the shop. So they always ask, when can I drive? In general, I say within 2 weeks, up to half an hour's time after first week, and then 4 weeks, up to 2 hours, then six hours, and after 8 weeks, unlimited. This is not a rule, not evidence-based, because they like to know how to do it. So it just gives them a confidence, oh, this should be okay. And I always get the feedbacks and see how they're progressing, and I'm collecting all the data. In the post-surgery in the ward, it's not just the patients and we, even the ward nurses, physiotherapists should know about this. They should be able to mobilize straight away because they were brought up with a different concept in the past. When you're changing, they must know what we're trying to do. Only thing that worries sometimes is the postural hypotension because of they've been fasting, they're dehydrated, they have opioids, all the things like that. So that's what we have to keep in mind when we tell the staff or keep an eye on the patient. Most of the infusions, they go home on first post-op day within 24 hours when I do single-level fusion. And two-level fusion or more, they tend to stay for 3 or 4 days. Otherwise, they tend to go on the same day. And how long can they sit? They say, I said 20 minutes plus, as the pain permits. And mobilize are normal. Encourage them with the self-help. That's the best thing for them to able to discharge. These are a few things of specific post-op rehab for me. Discectomy, 60 to 70% of my patients, they go home on the same day. I know most of you go to Korea Wardell Hospital where they do endoscopic. They can go home after 2 hours because of sedation and local anesthetic. But I'm talking about general microscopic surgery. 60 to 70% go on the same day, and I give general advice, they can do whatever they can. Only time we make them lie down is if there is a dural tear and it's symptomatic. As soon as the headaches are better, I get them going. I don't stick to 48 hours flat and things like, because nowadays with a microscope, we do repair dural tears and use gel, so there's hardly any leakage coming after that. But stabilization, people keep them flat on the bed for 3 days. I never understood the concept. And they also lie on the back, because if there's ulcer on the foot, we always ask them to elevate. So I start questioning, why are we asking this patient to lie on your back? Because there's a surgical ulcer on the back. And secondly, patient was unstable with listhesis before. He was walking around, we stabilized it. Only thing we have done is we mobilized the muscles. That's all we have done, the dissection, to fix it. So once the patient is stabilized, why do you ask them to lie down flat, not move? So these are the questions I always ask, and I get them going. And I have no regrets, they're doing well. And movements as they permit, light jobs they can do within 2 to 4 weeks. Only heavy jobs, like builders, I ask them to wait for 12 weeks. Non-destabilizing decompression, the most common I do, with a microscope, some of them use tube, and just discharge on the same day, about 60% of them. Generally, they are elderly patients, so they may stay for a day or two. It all depends upon their medical condition as well, and how cooperative, cognitive patients are. These are a few cases, example, like what I do in my practice, and mine is a university hospital, but more like a district general. If there's anything complex, we send to my colleague, Shan Mola, in so Royal National Orthopedic Hospital, which is a tertiary center. And this man is a 5'2", but 130 kgs weight with spondylolysis and listhesis. I stabilized him with the posterolateral stabilization and TLIF. He went home in, I think, with less than 48 hours. In 4 weeks, he's back working as a chef. This is another example of another patient. It's not the same patient. This is L4-5, which is more commonly done in my practice. Also do cervical thing. Even the cervical surgery, I don't use collar. Of course, I use a drain, but not a collar unless the patient is very apprehensive. And they generally go home within 48 hours. And this is a football coach, actually, for women's in England. 7 years he's suffering. And after stabilized, she went home within less than 48 hours because her activity and the mindset. She's a very active lady. And in 4 weeks, she's back coaching football to colleagues. Balloon kyphoplasty is another rapid rehab program, especially for elderly patients who are in a lot of pain and they need opioids. They can't breathe because of this problem. The moment you do this by balloon kyphoplasty, the pain decreases. Patient who's taking a lot of opioids, not managing just with the paracetamol. And these can be done even under local and sedation if they are not fit for general anesthesia. Incidentally, Ms. Shan Mala, who just spoke to you, he does maximum balloon kyphoplasties in UK actually for myeloma patients and others. And I do in my region. This is another example for very rarely we see Bartholotti syndrome. These are things, I just put up this slide just to know things like this exist. And when it removes the transverse process, she's walking normally the next day. And what mind doesn't know, eyes cannot see. So it's nice to know some of these conditions do exist. Thank you very much.
P.S. N.V. Prasad, he is going to talk on management of traumatic bone defect using bone Ilzarov technique. Sir. Yeah, third speaker is written. Traumatic bone defect using.
This is yours.
No, this is next. Okay. After that, sorry. Yeah.
This is a pointer and the slide changer.
Okay. So, Dr. P.S. N.V. Prasad.
P.N.V. S.V. Prasad. There is a small confusion between two Prasads and presenting this paper in front of Professor Junjunwala, the Assami President International, now maybe my privilege rather. And respected chairman and my friends. Treating segmental bone loss is a challenging task to the surgeon. Patient and his attendant should be very patient. Increased number of high velocity compound comminuted trauma has contributed to more number of segmental bone loss cases in the recent past. This segmental loss can be due to open fracture, which is with segmental bone loss and post debridement sometimes, and our blast injury in the wars, and because of infection or tumor resection. But mostly I'm confirming myself to the segmental bone loss with infection and trauma. I receive cases something like this, like immediate post-traumatic with bone loss, or sometimes a few weeks after initial injury with necrotic bone and on some support, external support like slab. And sometimes compound comminuted fractures on external fixation with necrotic bone and which has to be excised, or post-traumatic an external fix with already some surgeries were done like fibula transfer and vascular repair and flap cover, etc. And sometimes I receive operated Hilizaro, cannot do any further, calling me for rescue. And operated comminuted compound fractures which got with internal implants and got infected and so removed and implants along with infected bone. In all these cases, you have to evaluate the soft tissue envelope and the infection, whether it is deep or superficial, or joint contracture and range of motion. And nerve function has to be assessed, both motor and sensory. And vasculature has to be assessed because the previous surgeons might have kept them in a different position because of the previous surgeries. So you can do a Doppler or you can confirm with the angiogram. Sometimes evaluation should be, x-ray should be complete, full length, and location and size of the defect also matters, and the hardware that is remaining has to be tackled with. And in this case, the initial x-ray showed only 3 Schanz pins in position, but when an x-ray has been taken with including the upper end of the femur, there were 2 broken Schanz pins, which may interfere with your further bone transport procedures. General health of the host has to be taken into consideration, and psychosocial resources and economic constraints of the patient, because by the time they reach for the Hilizaro surgery, they might have been drained of their economy in total. The strategy should be like, which if the defect is less than 4 to 5 centimeters of bone loss, removal of loose fragments should be done, shaping of the edges, and acute decking can be done. If the wound is transverse like this, you can go for an acute decking. But if the wound is vertical, then you have to go for a gradual decking procedure. If the bone loss is between 5 and 10 centimeters, remove loose fragments, need not to shape the edges at this juncture, and catecotomy in the stable segment, that is at the upper end, for the lower third fracture, and bone transport has to be carried out. If it is more than 10 to 12 centimeters of bone loss, then frame assembly for double catecotomy, either tandem, something like this, and 2 levels of catecotomy, in one below the other, or a convergent type of catecotomy, one above and one below, depending upon the size of the segment on each side, can be done. Do not do the fibula osteotomy at this juncture, and transport till docking. Both segments should be transported till docking, 1 centimeter short of docking. And at strategies for both these all these types of this thing constitute transport at regular pace of 1 mm per day, and elevate invaginated skin at the time of just before docking, 1 centimeter before docking. There is some invaginated skin that has to be elevated, and fashion the edges at the docking site. And now you can do the fibula osteotomy at this time, and correct the angulations after fibula osteotomy. Immediately correct the angulations, rotations, and also the translation. Do not disturb the distraction at this juncture. Compress the docking, continue distraction if there is a need for further distraction to correct the LLD. accelerated shuttling can be done to achieve early docking. That means you can go for compression at the docking site and distraction at the Katikatme site. That means you can achieve docking early, but you will end up with limb LLD much more, but this can be distracted at a later date after docking, so that the hazarding process, process of union can be hazarding early. Intra-articular extension better stabilize with either CC screws or K-wires prior to the frame assembly, so that it will not get disturbed and the joint mobility will be much better. After docking, joint spanning frame can be removed. For doing femur, try to keep the knee in maximum flexion by using a suitable table attachment, something like that, so that you can keep the knee in maximum flexion, so that your knee movements can be improved after the frame removal. In post-implant infections, remove the implant and better wait for about 3 weeks, so that the infection, that is acute infection or the purulent infection, that the soft tissues can recover and the infection can be much better. Something like cases, this is a comminuted lower third femur intra-articular and little 4 to 5 centimeters of shortening. So we have done acute docking with intra-articular stabilization, and this is the final outcome, and this is the range of movement. This is a case of comminuted lower third compound femur with which was operated outside the blocking plate and got infected. They have removed the necrotic bone, but they have kept the implant, but they are not happy, and afterwards they have removed the implant also the bone, and patient came to me at this stage. But on X-ray, I found that there is some streaks of bone formation here, and so I thought that I'll stabilize it instead of docking. Like watchful expectancy and masterly inactivity is the dialogue of the gynecologist, but I tried to observe that in this case, and to my surprise, everything started forming, the new bone started forming, and this is the, I had done only a small bone graft at this, at the end, and the final result. This is another case where already vascular repair and then the fibula transfer has been done with the flap cover and all, and this is the transport, and I got good union. Another case of about 14 years boy with a lot of necrotic bone came to me after 15 days, and it has been stabilized, and the bone transport has been done, almost good union at this. A lot of bone has been removed at the time, and good bone transport has barrel shaped regenerate and good union. This is a range of movement. And another case where fibula tibia has been exposed, and that slide I have shown before, and that has been removed, and Elizaro has been applied to him, and bone transport was carried out, and at the end, at the time of docking, I felt that there is some abnormality in the docking part of the proximal segment. And on opening, I opened that with the doubt that, and finally I found that a small segment with two different laminae of bone rather than one single bone, and that I have excised and docked it again, and distracted further and docked it again, and this is the final result. Another case where almost lost about 25 centimeters of the bone in this, and only flakes of bone were seen in this with malunion at a upper end, and the normal bone is from here to here and from here to here. All the remaining bone is almost like flakes of pieces of bone that is remaining. Already flap covered and an external fixator, and he came to me without external fixator and on slab. And here I have applied a different frame for correction of this angulation, this, because this is looking at the malunion. So I want to retain this place, and I have done a CAD-CAM at this place, and I have applied a frame for correction of the angulation while getting it distracted. So that has been corrected and distracted, and finally they have darkened in the middle, exactly in the middle, and both the rings became parallel, and young 23 years. And I had done about 11 centimeters of distraction in the distal segment, and about 12 centimeters total, about 23 centimeters of distraction has been done in this case, and this is the range of movement, even after so much of bone transport. Another case where it's got infected, and the bone is totally infected, and lot of infected tissue was.
Please, some of fast,
okay,
please.
It's almost done. And another case with I have done a tandem transport. This middle piece has been necrosed compound type 3B, and tandem type of transport was carried out, and this is the range of movement after and regenerate. And in bone transport with Elizarov, there is high rate of ultimate success, good restoration of length and alignment, no donor site morbidity, functional during treatment. The main important thing is it takes about 1 to 2 years, and the patient will be functional during the treatment. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is supposed to be Dr. Gopak Kumar. So I request Dr. Gopak Kumar, please come and just give your talk. Welcome, sir. His topic is, it is displayed in the screen.
Mr. Chairman, friends, my topic is Ponseti technique in the correction of club foot. As you all know, club foot is a common congenital anomaly of the lower limb, and it is a challenging problem to manage. If you look at the epidemiology, the average incidence is around 1.2 per 1,000 population, and there are at least 50,000 new cases in India. If you look at the spectrum of club foot deformity, based on the cause, it can be either postural, idiopathic, or secondary. Based on the treatment, it can be corrected, uncorrected, recurrent, resistant, neglected, or complex. By far, the commonest is the idiopathic, which is an isolated club foot in an otherwise normal child. But in your busy club foot clinic, you may see neuropathic, myopathic, osteopathic, and syndromic club foot. A new word has been added by the Ponseti group, that is the atypical club foot. It is a severe club foot where the correction stops after 2 to 3 casts, and the casts fall off. The foot is short with a cocked up date toe. There is a deep transverse crease and a plantaris deformity. The assessment is usually done by the Piranesi score, which has got a midfoot contracture score and a hindfoot contracture score and a total score of around 6. The usefulness of this method is that it takes hardly 1 minute to assess the severity of the deformity, and you can identify, that is, when the midfoot score comes to 0 and the hindfoot score, hindfoot correction is not obtained, you have to do a tenotomy. So the aim of treatment of club foot is to achieve a foot with appearance and function that is nearly normal and remain normal throughout the lifetime. Various techniques are available for that, of which the gold standard has become the Ponseti technique. We used to do quite a lot of surgery, but various series have shown that the functional results have been reported to be better if extensive surgery can be avoided. Reoperation is required in more than half of these surgically treated cases, and risk of serious complications are sometimes more difficult to treat. What has caused the change is the work of this great man, Ignacio Ponseti, and he said that our patients treated 25 to 42 years ago, it was found that although the treated club foot were less supple than the normal feet, there were no significant difference in the function or performance compared to a population of similar age with normal feet. What is this Ponseti technique? It is a serial casting of the lower limb using a strictly defined technique. Once the foot is corrected, an abduction foot orthosis is given. The tenotomy is done at the hind foot stole, and tibialis anterior transfer for a dynamic supination deformity. If you look at the pathoanatomy, the main points are the talus and calcaneum are in severe flexion. The calcaneum navicular and the cuboid are adducted and inverted. The navicular tuberosity is close to the medial malleolus. The most important is the concept of calcaneopedal block, where the forefoot moves as a unit with calcaneum, and this unit is termed as the calcaneopedal block. So in short, there are only two structures. One is the talus and the other is the calcaneopedal block. The calcaneopedal block moves around the talus, and the motion of the intertarsal and tarsometatarsal joints can be disregarded. The steps are mainly: the cavus has to be corrected first by elevating the big toe. In this position, the foot is abducted with your thumb over the head of the talus as the fulcrum, and gradually the abduction is increased, and this stretches the medial tarsal ligaments, and the calcaneum abduct with the foot, and the anterior tuberosity of the calcaneum is disengaged from the position under the head of the talus. The equinus is not corrected by manipulation. In more than 90% of the cases, it requires an Achilles tenotomy. It should be performed when sufficient abduction around 70 degrees is achieved by abducting the foot. We do the tenotomy under local anesthesia, not in the office setting but in the OT. I usually apply a local anesthetic cream, the top lap cream, half an hour before the procedure, and the children are usually comfortable with the procedure. After this, the long leg cast is applied for 3 weeks to allow the tendo-Achilles to heal, and it is given in 70 degree of external rotation and maximum dorsiflexion. The heel varus need not be corrected separately. As with abduction, the heel varus will get corrected. And following this, it goes into the bracing phase when this Steenbeck brace is applied. In a bilateral case, 70 degree of external rotation is given, and in a unilateral case, 70 degree of external rotation to the affected feet and 45 degree to the normal feet. It should be worn for 23 hours a day for the first 3 months, and then night only for 2 to 4 years. The compliance with the bracing protocol is the most challenging aspect of the Ponseti technique of treatment. So this is one child with the Pirani score 6. The first, the forefoot, the big toe is elevated and then gradually abducted with your thumb at the head of the talus as the fulcrum, and the cast is applied. When the Pirani score, midfoot score comes to 0, you do a tenotomy to correct the equinus, followed by the bracing phase. The relapse do occur, and it can either be a forefoot relapse or a hindfoot relapse. The treatment of relapse is repeat casting to regain correction and continue with the brace. Surgery is required in less than 3% of the cases. When there is a dynamic supination deformity, you may have to do a tibialis anterior transfer, which is usually done when the child is around 2.5 years old and when the X-ray shows that the lateral cuneiform is ossified. The various results in the literature show that it gives around 80 to 90% good results. Our experience, we started the Ponseti clinic with the help of the CURE group in August 2011, and we were able to treat 350 children, of which data is available for 150 children in 239 feet, 87 good results, and 30 cases of relapse which was treated by recasting and tenotomy. These are some of our children. And this is the so-called atypical club foot, the short fat feet with a dorsiflex metatarsal and a deep plantar crease. And here we were able to treat her conservatively with a reasonably good results. These are some of other cases. The lower slide shows the forefoot deformity. These are some of the happy children which we have in our clinic. Can it be used for rigid club foot? Yes, it can be used for rigid club foot, because it is not the rigidity, it is your technique of treatment and treating early that decides the ultimate result. In neglected club foot, it can be used, and this paper shows that it is a safe and effective method for treating neglected club foot. We have got experience of 37 children within 61 club feet, the average between the age of 10 months and 16 years, and we got around 72% success rate with this treatment. These are some of the children, a 5-year-old, after 4 casts, and at the age of 16 casts and tenotomy, he had a normal plantigrade feet. Another boy, with 14-year-old boy with very severe club foot, again at the end of 16 casts, the foot has become plantigrade. In short, Ponseti method has revolutionized the treatment of club foot. It can correct club foot deformity in 90% of cases. It avoids extensive surgical procedures, and the long-term result of surgical treatment is disappointing. It can be used in older children, and it may be successful even in relapsed and neglected club foot. Thank you for the patient here.
Not moving. क्या हुआ? नहीं आ रहा.
नहीं आ रहा.
मुझे काम है. हमें चाहिए नहीं ये फोन.
इससे बनेस.
करो ना. ओके. अच्छा दिस वन.
नहीं.
These two, not this one.
The last reverse.
Achha, achha. Okay. Good afternoon, Chairman. First of all, I want to thank Dr. Maria and the IUACON team for inviting me. And here I am just to share my experience about infected non-union and what we are doing in Nepal. So we'll the objective is that the problem here we see in infected non-union is the causes of disturbed bone healing in developing countries, and how we will be manage it, the principles and some local adaptation for infection non-union, and then we can have the discussion in the end. Neglected injuries, if you see, Nepal is a country, is a hilly country. We have the top of the world, Mount Everest, and the geography is so difficult that most of the time it is difficult for our patient to come to the hospital in time. And even if they come to the hospital, then the number of orthopedic surgeons is not sufficient enough to provide them proper orthopedic care. So generally, it is treated by the health assistant or the local healer, and most of the time there is a failure of diagnosis also. And then even if it is diagnosed properly, then the treatment is also inappropriate. And all these is further added by complication of infection. Primary orthopedic surgeons, in most of the part in Nepal, we have almost 150 plus orthopedic surgeons. Most of us are centered in Kathmandu, so still the country lacks a lot of orthopedic surgeons. So majority of the cases are taken care by the local people who are the health assistant, not properly trained for these orthopedic emergencies, and these leads to frequent loss of life or limb. Fracture healing, just in short, we all know, I don't want to go into detail. There is stage of inflammation, then we have the soft callus formation, and then you have hard callus, and this is the bridging gap where if it is not treated properly, it goes into non-union. So what are the cause of this disturbed bone healing? We all know, if the biology due to the poor vascularity, mechanics due to the instability, or the comorbidities of the patients, all these lead to disturbance in the bone healing, and if it is superadded by infection. I'm thankful to Professor Thomas Rudy when he visited last time in Kathmandu during one of our principal course, and in that time I'm sharing this slide from him, and this was a case from Nigeria where you can see the x-ray and see the bony prominence, the lower end of the femur protruding almost out of the skin, and he has 13 centimeter of shortening, stiff foot, ankle and knee with a discharging sinus. So infected non, this was diagnosed as infected non-union with 13 centimeter shortening. So what will be our plan during that time? If it was in 1975, slow distraction with bilateral external fixator to gain the length, and after 2 weeks 95 degree angle blade was applied, and then the patient went back home and he didn't appear, and when he came after certain time, the wound has healed and the bone has also healed. So what we see here is that infected non-union requires high stability, and this was the follow-up. No other surgery was needed. When he landed up after 2 weeks, we can see that there is no sign of infection, but although there was 3 centimeter of shortening, limited flexion, but the important thing was full weight bearing. So you can see it. This is the, so what is infection non-union? If you ask me, a state of failure of union and persistence of infection at the fracture site for 6 to 8 months. Associated factors, we all know, compromised vascularity, systemic compromise on the host, virulent of the organisms, nowadays biofilm formation on the implants, and devascularized bone surfaces protects pathogens and may lead to persistence of infection. So the treatment strategy has been two stages. The most important thing was to control the infection, and for this it was the surgical debridement. This is very important that you have to be very perfect about this debridement. And then that can be followed by special reconstructive procedures and soft tissue procedures. And then you have to add local antibiotic therapy, which is useful technique that results in high local concentration of antibiotic. The method in the form of methacrylate beads as used in the treatment of osteomyelitis and open fracture has also been used. But here in the second stage, once the infection is controlled, then we go for stabilization of the fractures. So the first stage